People matter to God, every single one of them. Jesus was born for people, lived for people, died for people, conquered sin and death for people. As we prepare to celebrate Easter, it's time to let people know this day is for them. This is our calling, our commission. The power of the resurrection has changed our lives, but it's not meant to stop there. The life-changing love of the cross, the unquenchable passion of the grave, the unbeatable power which rolled away the stone is meant to pierce the hearts of people. This Easter, don't keep it to yourself. Step out, reach out, speak out, and invite.
Good morning. Did y'all pay attention to the video?
Yes.
All right, we're good. Thank you so much. Well, that was like the quick 1 minute version of what we're going to talk about today. So spoiler alert, that's it. That's the main point, right? And I'm here because we're going to start this two-part series on Reach One. As the Easter season is coming along, it's a challenge that we usually hear churches do at this time of the year, where as churches prepare for Easter, of encouraging its congregation to just invite one person. Think, pray, seek that one person that you want to introduce to the Lord. Get to know them, spend time with them, speak with them, speak truth to them, love them, invite them to church. Help them experience with you the joy that you have in the Lord. But every year we hear this message and we wonder, how does it work? And if you were like me, when I was a teenager, the word evangelism to me is scary. And was I the only one? Anyone still scared of that word? Anyone? Have you all heard the word when you were younger and people tried to teach you how to witness? The witnessing thing? Man, I'm very few people understand what I'm saying here. So when I was a teenager, someone came to me when I was 14. I was already attending youth group. I was already a part of the church, but I really didn't understand the gospel well. And someone came to me, and which is really interesting because on that specific Wednesday night youth group, I was one of the people that was actually leading the youth group service. And one of the young pastors came to me after service and go, "Dennis, if you were to die tonight, do you know where you're going to go?" "Why do you think I'm going to die tonight?" It's a hard question to think about. And I was asked that. I'm like, okay, keep going. Where are you going with this? And then he shared me the gospel. He just said that, you know, everyone sinned. And I'm sure you can understand that we fail. And that this sin now separates you from God. Unfortunately, there's not enough prayers or good deeds or anything that can save you from that sin. And only Christ takes care of that sin on the cross. So he invites you to a relationship with him. And so if you open your heart and invite him to your life, then forever you would understand that you belong to him. So when this life is over, you get to spend eternity with him in heaven. Amen. And I'm like, that's pretty simple. That's pretty cool. That's pretty, and I go, what do I do now? So right there in front of other youth group people, I prayed. And I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I was 14 years old. I was still trying to learn what that actually meant at that time. And I remember being, and y'all gonna love this, processed into understanding what that faith is all about. And at that time, at 14, 15, all you're thinking about is this, what did I get myself into? Anyone here on that? I'm bearing my soul here, y'all. and the concept that I should be doing the same thing that young pastor did to me, I go, are you crazy? You want me to say those same words and share that same truth that you call the gospel, the goodness of Jesus Christ to other people? You know, one way of receiving it, that's one thing. For me to share it now, it's kind of crazy. And shortly after that, I got to college and I got involved with this organization called Campus Crusade of Christ. Maybe you heard of it. Maybe just a few of you. I think the cool young people call it Crew now. And I was introduced to this track called The Four Spiritual Laws by this guy named Bill Bright. I even attended a crusade conference back in the Philippines back then when he was there, and it was a big deal. And we got loads of this material. And when I was in college, they told us to go to the campus grounds in groups and just go share the four spiritual laws. And I went, and it was more like, okay, how do you do this? Am I saying the right things? What am I supposed to do? And here's the truth of how God's grace is so amazing. I know that I was able to speak to several people, and people prayed that prayer. I cannot remember one name. I think I shared with you all before, I was so brave enough because of the project, of the mission of doing this, that I would go to a classroom and ask my teacher, hey, do you mind if I speak for a little bit? Teachers back then, they were like, oh, sure, give me a break. And I wrote the entire four spiritual laws on the chalkboard and just did it and presented it to the whole class and invited them to pray with me. And I'm sure some prayed. But again, it's only by grace. As I got older, I began to think to myself, what does this really mean? Is my Christianity simply based upon how many people will I get to pray to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior? Is this what my faith life is about? Is there a scoreboard in heaven? How am I doing? Pretty competitive here, so I want to know how I'm doing compared to everybody else. But as I got older, went to college, understood, moved to the States, I began to realize more and more. I'm like, you know what? It's not that simple. And then I started getting scared. And I stopped doing it. Through my young adult years, I was more fearful. Maybe you're feeling the same way. Again, this is confessional time. This is me bearing my soul. I hope you're staying with me here. Me understanding, like, what if they don't want to be friends with me? What if they reject me because of what I have to tell them? Is this proselyting? Is this forcing my truth to someone else's down someone else's throat and forcing them to it? Am I so good with my words that I can debate them to it? Am I so eloquent, so kind, so generous, so nice that I can force someone to understanding the gospel? You know what that taught me? That it's not Dennis's gospel. That it's not my truth. But it's his truth. Took me a while to get there. That's what I want to talk about today. Is that cool? And I invite you to look back. Who invited you to church the first time? Who introduced you to the gospel? Who in that moment in your life that decided, you know what? I'm going to love you enough that I'm going to share you the truth about Jesus Christ. Why it's so hard to tell people about Jesus? Did we forget how to make friends? Scared of making friends? Do we still believe that God is in the business of changing lives, including yours and mine? Romans 10, beginning from verse 10. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. As the scripture tells us, anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Jew and Gentile are the same in this respect. They have the same Lord who gives generously to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be what? Is it someone? Is it just a few? Is there a prerequisite there? No. Is there a qualifier? It says everyone. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they have never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? Well, it's kind of basic here, right? Well, duh. And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? So that's what the scriptures, why the scriptures say, how beautiful are the feet of messengers who bring the good news. So this is the good news. That Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died for our sins, rose again, eternally forgiving, so that there is now no condemnation for those who believe, but only have everlasting joy. That's the gospel. That's why we are here, to worship Him who is the way, the truth, and the life. Others coming to Jesus does not ultimately depend on you or I or Brandon or Matt or the amazing worship team that we have leading us in singing or the delicious food that we have for refreshments and all the wonderful greeters that meet you every Sunday. They all take part. We all take part in sharing the gospel. But ultimately, it's not us, because John 6:44 says, no one can come to me, Jesus speaks, unless the Father who sent me draws him. No one can come to the saving faith if God is not at work in his or her life and her heart, or in his heart. And this is the one and the most, this is really important. Knowing that it's the Lord's work. This is one of those freeing, releasing, no more pressure statements, understandings, truth about the gospel that you and I need to understand. It is an honor for us to be used by the Lord, but the Lord does not need you or I to do this. The joy is in the fact that He invites us, that we get to do it, and the joy of being able to serve Him and be used by Him. Guys, there's no better high, there's no better feeling, there's no better joy than to know that the Lord has used you. For someone who's going to be eternally separated from Him to now being able to live joyously in Him forevermore. Amen. But what happened? Do you still have that passion? Do I still have that passion? What happened to that truth, that same excitement of coming to know that this promise is for you and and there's a joy to share it? What happened to that passion that we sometimes feel that it's not there? And because we know this, because we believe it, because we live for this, we share it with all. And not to share it means we either don't believe it, or we've depreciated or made less of the truth of it. Or the hard truth is maybe simply we don't care that others would know. You know, I don't know about you. I always am fascinated with magic shows. Anyone like magic here? Yeah, I remember doing Hurricane Irma. Kaden was just a baby. Emily Ann was 2.5 years old. And we escaped to Georgia, spent a couple of nights there just to not be here for Irma, for Hurricane Irma. And being stuck in a hotel room, y'all did this just for like just a few days during the pandemic? Oh, no, months during the pandemic. Oh, a year during the pandemic, just being stuck at home together. But I remember being sitting in a hotel room like, there's only so much you can entertain a 2.5-year-old being stuck in a hotel room. And so I did the magic trick, right? Y'all know the pulling of the finger. I can't show it because my daughter would know. She still doesn't know that that's how you do the pulling the finger trick. Don't tell her. Don't tell her. So during the pandemic, I actually did this trick again. And when Kaden was old enough to know, and Kaden was like, and to this day, last night, I just asked him, do you guys remember the pulling the finger trick? Yeah, Daddy, do it again. Do you know how it's done? No. You know, I wonder about this because I remember when I think about sharing Jesus with someone who is a skeptic, it makes me wonder if they're just simply watching, listening, paying attention, as if I'm about to do some kind of magic. That what I'm sharing is something that they already are convinced is not real. And they're just trying to figure out how they can catch the illusion and prove me wrong. There's a TV show out there that I don't follow, but when I'm channel surfing, I see it. It's called Penn and Teller's Fool Us. Have you guys seen that show? Where magicians come, or illusionists come, and because Penn and Teller are so master magicians or illusionists, that they would these other magicians would try to see if they can fool them, they can trick them. And the grand prize is if you can actually trick them, you get to be invited to their show in Las Vegas to be a part of the opening act. So this is a big deal. So anyone from beginner illusionists to grand illusionists are going trying to get to the show just to be able to do this. But Penn Jillette, the talkative, well, the other one doesn't speak. Penn Jillette is a verbal, the verbal one is one of the popular magicians out there, is actually a very outspoken atheist. Gillette, during an interview with the American Humanist Association, that's the atheist group, shared that he grew up in a family that actually went to church. Penn Jillette said, "I finished reading the Bible and told my pastor I was an atheist. The pastor was hip enough to keep me in the youth group for about a year until he finally told my parents when he was 16. Your son is doing a better job at turning the children atheists than I am turning them Christian. So please stop coming to church." I got that reprieve and began referring to myself as an atheist, he continues, at 16. And now it's been 40 years that I've been out and speaking boldly as an atheist. So many years ago, someone shared with me a Penn and Jillette, a recording of a YouTube video. Maybe you've seen it. It's been around for about a decade and a half. After one of the magic shows, a man about Gillette's age came to the show and said, "I brought this for you." And the man held up a small book. It was a New Testament with the Psalms, so it's the Gideon Bible, the pocket version, something that could fit in the person's pocket, as Gillette said. "I wrote in the front of it," the man said, "and I wanted you to have it." The man explained that he was a businessman and that he's not crazy. Gillette, moved by the man's gesture, recalled, "He was kind and nice and sane and looked me in the eyes and talked to me, and then he gave me this Bible." "I've always said," Gillette explained, "I don't respect people who don't proselytize. I don't respect that at all. If you believe there is a heaven and hell, and people could be going to hell and or not getting eternal life or whatever, and you think it's not really worth telling them this because it would make it socially awkward." Gillette continues, "How much do you have to hate somebody to not proselytize? How much do you have to hate someone to believe everlasting life is possible and not tell them that?" Gillette continued, "If I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that a truck was coming at you and you didn't believe it, that the truck was bearing down on you and there's a certain point that I tackle you, and this is more important than that." This guy was a really good guy. He was polite, he was honest, sane, and he cared enough about me to proselytize and give me a Bible. Gillette said, "I know there's no God. And one polite person living in his life right doesn't change that. But I'll tell you, he was a very, very, very good man. And that's really important. And with that kind of goodness, it's okay to have that deep of a disagreement. I still think religion does a lot of bad stuff, but man, that was a good man who gave me that book. That's all I wanted to say." And the video ended. It's so weird that the motivation to share Jesus came from someone who does not believe in God. How much do you have to hate somebody to not proselytize? How much do you have to hate someone to believe everlasting life is possible and not tell them that? I have a brother who's 3.5 years younger than me, followed by a sister who's just a year younger than him. And then I have another sister who's much younger than me. But I remember thinking about this when I was sitting with them. And I just sat down with them. I go, "Hey, I need to tell you something." And I didn't share the gospel with my siblings in the most spectacular way. But I shared to them with concern. I shared with each one together, actually. And I said, I don't want you all to go to hell. And this is what I know, and this is what I believe. What leads us to this passage in Luke 15, a very popular one. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. Okay, Dad, I didn't say that my siblings are tax collectors and sinners. I just realized the transition is bad. But Luke 15, verse 1. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." You know, I had to actually look at the dictionary what grumbling actually means. Is it the grumbling I know? And then I realize it's that making a low rumbling sound, expressing a complaint in a bad-tempered way. So I realized this, grumbling is not good. Especially when directed towards Jesus or the ones Jesus decided to hang out with. It's hard to love and grumble at the same time. Do you recognize that? You will not be able to reach. I will not be able to reach. We will not be able to reach those that we are grouchy towards, right? Luke 15, 3, 6. This is how the parable is explaining it as Jesus speaks. So he told them in this parable, Jesus said, "What man of you having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.'" Luke 15, 7. "Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." Pastor Matt last Sunday spoke on a similar passage found in Matthew 18 using the same parable as he closed our series and hit refresh. And one of the points Pastor Matt made is about the pursuit of the lost. Pastor Matt reminded us in the parable, the lost sheep is great if we identify with that one sheep that is prone to wander. But what if we thought like the 99 sheep that were not lost, or so they thought. Pastor Matt said, "It is easy for me to look at that one sheep that wandered away and simply brush them off." Jesus is telling us that we, as his followers, are to pursue the one when they go astray, that we are to relentlessly track them down in order to restore them to the body of Christ. This time in Luke 15, Jesus uses the same parable, but this time it's not one who has wandered or gone astray. Rather, it's for someone that is lost, a sinner, a tax collector, someone the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled about, saying, "This man, Jesus, receives sinners and eats with them." So the command, go and look for the one that is lost. Luke 15, verse 8, as it continues, "Or what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the one coin that I had lost.'" 15, verse 10, check this out. "Just so I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents." So do we still rejoice? Is there still joy in you when someone comes to know Christ? I love it when we do baptisms here and we celebrate it and we bring people here, those that are confessing openly that they come to know Jesus, they have now a new life in Christ, and we all clap and we all celebrate. Yay, that's wonderful. That's a good thing. That's something to rejoice about. But how much of that do we take out outside this building? How much of that rejoicing are you excited about when you're looking to someone, speaking with someone, know someone, sitting beside someone at work, or in school, or in class, or in your school bus? People still ride school buses? I think. I don't know. People you play basketball with. Is this still that anticipation of joy? That person is someone that will get to know Jesus. That will experience new life in him. And then Luke 15:11, you know the parable well. And he said, there was a man who had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of my property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Now many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. And yet, no one gave him anything. What was it like to be lost? Do we still have compassion for those that are lost? Do we feel that they deserve what they got because of the bad decisions they made? Therefore, they're lost. Jesus, was it that man who sinned, or was it his parents or his grandparents? Why they're so blind? Do we still feel discerning what they got? Toiling in the pig pen, eating the slop, living on the streets, homeless, abandoned, in prison because of a crime they commit, hopeless because they destroyed every relationship they had. The one who is so desperate for hope, ready to be a slave, to fall at his father's feet and beg for mercy. You know, the prodigal did not return home thinking that he will be back as the master's son, but rather as the master's servant. In the same way, we repent, as a repentant sinner coming to God is aware of his own spiritual poverty, spiritual challenges. Laying aside all pride and feeling of entitlement, he brings nothing of value with him. The sinner's only thought is to cast himself at the mercy of God and beg for a position as of a servant. 1 John 1:8-9, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Even when the prodigal was heading home, not fully understanding to what is to happen, before he fully understood what repentance's consequences may mean, and while he was still a long way off, the father will come running. The father will be weeping with joy and orchestrating the greatest, grandest celebration ever. Not because he arrived at the right combination of spiritual practices or doing good or praying so many prayers or feeling so guilty. Not because he promised to never leave home again, but because ever since the son left, the father has been pacing, praying, hoping, and watching passionately for any glimpse for his lost son to come home. Be ready to provide rest and rejuvenation. That's how we welcome a prodigal. And yet we don't do that, do we, church? We expect them to be a certain way. We expect them to act just like the way we act. We expect them to dress, speak, do as we do. As if they already knew. Luke 15:18. Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. The prodigal said, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion in him and embraced him and kissed him. Is that how I see a prodigal? Or am I so mature that you need to be a certain way before I open my arms and embrace you for who you are? The father waited. The father was dealing with someone he loves, but that someone has a will of his own that he does not control, but he was ready to greet if he returned. You know, according to reports by the Pew Research Center, it's a popular Christian research group. On the last research, this just came out this past week, actually, from research, follow-up research from 2019. They said that nearly two-thirds of Americans say they personally know someone who is an evangelical Christian. So two-thirds of Americans, two-thirds of the people that live in America, say they actually know someone who confesses Jesus as their Lord. So the rich one already knows you. Did you hear me? The chances are the rich one, the one that we are challenged to do, already knows you. So it's not staring aimlessly in the crowd. It's already someone that you know. How we stop feeling compassionate that though they are still a long way off, are we eager to run towards and embrace the prodigal? The lesson here is welcome with open arms and eager anticipation. Luke 15:25. Some people don't like this passage. I don't either. Now his older son was in the field, and he came and drew near to the house. He heard the music and the dancing, and he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has received him back safe and sound." But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, "Look, these many years I have served you, and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me even a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him." See, I understand that can be uncomfortable. Strangers, people different than we are, stir up fear, discomfort, suspicion, hostility. They make us lose our sense of security just by being different, simply by being other. Only when we fully claim that God loves us in the same unconditional way and look at us, those others, as equally loved, do those messed up hindrances, sorry, that's a biblical word, messed up, all those foolish things will go away. Only when we fully claim that God loves us in an unconditional way did those prejudgment gradually disappear. Luke 15:32. "It was fitting to celebrate and be glad," the father said, "for this brother of yours was dead and is alive. He was lost and now he is found." Why is it that we are more comfortable sharing opinions regarding preferences, whether it be politics or food or travel? We're more comfortable talking about these things than we are talking about Jesus. We're sometimes more comfortable complaining about what is wrong with the unbelievers' habits and choices, as if those who are not yet in Christ should think and act and speak like those who are already in Christ. We expect them to walk just like us, talk like us, dress like us, smell like us. Be comfortable in this Sunday environment that we have here. You know what would be weird? If you or I were to go to a non-Christian worship gathering or an atheist meeting and be comfortable with it. So why do we expect the one that's still seeking, the one that's still trying to figure out, to be so comfortable with us? Do you hear me? I mean, some of us would go to another Christian church of a different denomination with a different style of worship and be uncomfortable. And yet those people speak the same name of Jesus, praise the same Jesus, understand that they are sinners that need forgiveness and have begged for Christ to come into their life. And yet we are not comfortable in settings we don't like. So church, here's the challenge. It's not really the understanding of, well, this is my church. This is how I like things. This is how it's supposed to be. Help me out. I want to invite my friends here that don't know Jesus. I want to invite my family who don't know Jesus to come join us. Can you make it welcoming for them? Yes. Don't you feel the same? I'm sure there are many of you here who've been for decades been praying for that one that you love. They're praying for them to come back to Christ. What can we do to make this place comfortable for them? Because we cannot just preach down on someone so that they would act like us. And we cannot preach someone to submission thinking that that's how they will discover Jesus. The last time I checked, that's not how it works. Yes, there will be a period of adjustment. Remember that you and I have been redeemed not because we deserve it, but because God thought we were worth it. God decided that coming to us as a baby in a manger, living a life misunderstood and condemned, stripped of his clothes, took on the lashes on his body, took the nails on his hands and on his feet, and dying naked on that cross for everyone to witness. God decided it was worth it for you, for me. And God decided it was worth it for them. God decided it was worth it for them. Sharing the gospel does not end when someone comes to know Christ or begins to repent or turn or walk into our door. You know that it's a whole growing thing, right? Remember, I remember well how life changed the first time we brought in Emily Ann to our home. Preparing for it, the moment we found out that Dana was pregnant, everyone was so excited. I felt like everyone else was more excited than I was. Everybody was coming, preparing a home, got the crib ready, everything ready, multiple diaper pails. I didn't expect that baby to know everything, to be walking, to be helping clean, to be doing what I'm supposed to do. Why do I expect someone that's coming to Christ to be all that when they're just still in the level of discovery? Don't we do that? The gospel of Jesus is not only good news for you or for me. It is good news for everyone. Amen. Amen. It is all worth it. All this awkwardness, all this adjusting, it's worth it. Because it was worth it for you. It was worth it for me. It is all worth it just like it was for you and I. Let me end with something from Henry Nouwen when he wrote, "Does God Really Care?" He said, "The pressures of living in our society makes us react to questions and problems more with bitterness, resentment, and even hatred. Far from being inspired, we seem to have forgotten about God. We are cynical about so much suffering in ourselves and in the world that we do not know how to integrate that with our own spiritual aspirations. And in a love-hate relationship, feelings of deep disillusionment color our capacity to relate with the one we once accepted and tried to follow. We feel ambivalent and dissatisfied, wondering if God can really be trusted and if God really is a personal God who is close to the brokenhearted. We aren't questioning this with words, but rather questioning it with our behaviors. Our behaviors betray us. We say to a friend, 'I will pray for you,' but we walk away without any sense of a commitment to pray because we have doubts about our own prayers being answered. We listen to sermons and lessons affirming the benefits of a life of communion with God and others, but somewhere deep down, we really believe that it is our action, not prayer, that satisfies needs. We may think prayer is a good when there's nothing more important to do, but we have strong reservations and doubts about God's effectiveness in our world, or of God's interest in our lives, or of God's interest in someone else's. We are no longer conscious of God with us. Church family, believe that God has his arms wide open and eager to welcome those who are lost. Start praying for that one. Pray for that one. Spend time and talk to that one. Invite that one. Reach one." Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, as we look at these stories of your truth, we wonder if we are still as passionate as we were back then. Our first love, because you first loved us, because you took us just the way we are, not holding back your love, showing us fully in the cross. Thank you for rescuing us. Thank you for your forgiveness that we've never deserved. And thank you that we get to share this good news with that one. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.